welcome to Hope Academy and Hope Academy High School Spring Drama Production. Tonight you will hear stories of redemption, of optimism and hope. So we're going to ask you to sit back, to relax. Mr. Ziegler, I'll loosen your tie a little bit. And be prepared to be amazed by all the hard work, the fruit of the hard work of these students. These young men and women have been working very hard for you. And so without further ado, I'm going to pray and then we're going to get started. So please join me in prayer. Father, we want to thank you for your son. For he is our redemption, our optimism, and our hope. So we pray that our performance tonight will be as sweet as incense to your nostrils this evening. So Lord, please bless this evening. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here tonight. So in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Journey of life. It all begins with the author and finisher of life, God, the great creator. And with wisdom, love, and a sense of mystery and wonder, our God has orchestrated our lives and is writing a story with the ultimate purpose of declaring, demonstrating, and display love, glory, and the fame of God's name. The metaphor of a journey for this life, you know, it provides a great frame for us to view our spiritual life and our relationship with God. Viewing life as a journey can help us make some sense of all the challenges, unexplained events, and even the mundane, and we find ourselves as searchers, travelers on this journey called life. All of us from different places, different cultures, perspectives, and not to mention the fact that we all carry some kind of baggage along the journey. And we're just trying to understand, to make sense of the mysteries of life, of the pains of life. Yet trusted that it's all ordered by our great creator. Now maybe this metaphor tonight of a journey might be of help to you, because I believe we're all searching desperately for hope. On this journey we find ourselves as on crossroads, faced with daily decisions that sometimes big or small, making the choice between the path of righteousness or that wide path of comfort. We find ourselves wrestling and debating at this crossroad. Should I go left or should I go right?
Welcome to the crossroads. Hang on, how did I get here? I can't remember. It's all just a blur. Well, I better get back on track. I will go left again. It's not as good as I thought, but it's something. This journey started out very fun, but it's all same old now. If that's all life is, then why even live? They're saying it'll all get better, but there's something missing inside. I guess I'll get there someday. I will go left again. But hang on a minute. What if I went a different way? What if I went right? I've heard stories, myths, of people finding true joy. Can that be true? True love, happiness, fulfillment. No, that cannot be true. Can it? Oh, I have no idea. Oh, I'm so torn. I feel a pull both ways. I don't know what to do. Oh, can I get a little help here? Wait, who is that? Did he just smile at me? No one's done that in a long time. Which way will he go? Left? I mean right? He charged right in, no hesitation. What does he know? There was something in his smile. In his eyes. What does he have? I think I should follow him. I want what he has. I think. Oh, I don't know. Does any of this even matter? Do I go left? Do I go back to that life? The parties were fun. The drugs were cool. But all of it ends in emptiness. Or do I go right? At a glance, all I see is a narrow, rocky, overgrown jungle of a path. But if I look closely, I see a distant light peering through the trees. A pure, promising light. But is it worth it? I've seen what the toll the world takes on people. I'm going right. I am going right. Who knows? Maybe the stories are true for once. Oh, please, please don't fail me now.
Individual spiritual journeys on life are filled with unexpected turns. Now, many of you can relate to the reality that the road we walk, this life we live, it was filled with ditches, detours, delays, and some days might leave us feeling a little discouraged, deflated, even depressed. All the weariness and feeling overwhelmed. We face that on the crossroads. And then along the journey, our travels take us into some dark and shadowy places. What we call that the valley experience.
Maybe I'll be found. It's bright. I see it right there, light. In the distance, I see it, it's there. But everything screams, wanting my attention, pulling at me, grabbing at my legs, slowing me down. So close, almost there. They weren't kidding
when they said that my path might be narrow. Just 5 footsteps in and my walls are closing. I've never been more claustrophobic than this very moment. I'm nauseous. I take a step off to make sure I can still breathe. But here, I'm not sure if there's any oxygen. Step back off.
Then I'm not. Hands pull me down violently, and I land in the middle of a valley. Valley for miles, ash sits in piles encircling me. But it's cold and it's dark, and the ash is warm, so I lay down. It comes and covers me like a gray blanket. Comforting. Sleep tight. One foot
in front of the other. How tempting it may seem to look back, how tempting it seems, but how empty it would be, because whenever I retrace my reminded of the scars that wide path bore. Reminded of that total darkness. The empty that I would feel even with the whole world surrounding me. Maybe I just don't want the world. Step forward.
I wake, feeling warm, yet confused. Feeling small, the valley is tall, towering over, fear comes. Why am I here? What am I doing? Is this a dream? No, it's not. So, I remember, I was dragged, and I feel everything. Bruises paint my skin like a canvas. Pain, blood, red, like puddles of rain.
Despite this,
only being a shadow.
I often mistake it for the valley of death. It's all right though. I'll keep treading on because for me, or for us, death has already been conquered. Because, well,
he's already walked this path.
So the journey of life takes us in and through those valleys and shadowy places. It's there we face our darkest fears and we wrestle with our strongest temptations. And if not for the promise that our great shepherd is with us and has gone before us even, we would have no hope of trying to continue to walk and stay on the path of righteousness. The journey of life presents painful paths for us. Paths filled with tears and shame, deep grief. And many people groups from different ethnicities and cultures throughout history have known the bitter reality of walking on those painful paths of oppression and injustice. So whether reading biblical stories of God's chosen Jewish people enduring the cruel hand of slavery under an Egyptian pharaoh, and later even through the Holocaust, we see many accounts of different people groups, all image bearers of God, our great creator, from every tribe, nation, and tongue that have had to walk bitter trails of oppression. Our native indigenous sisters and brothers of this land know all too well of painful paths of oppression and injustice. The story of the Trail of Tears that the Cherokee people traveled in 1838 at the order of President Andrew Jackson is a shameful example from American history of one of those painful paths that people created in the image of God had to walk under the oppression of cruel people.
Not stop crying. Pull yourself together, girl. Do you want us all dead? Hialeah scolded, though I saw a tear trail down her own. I let the tears fall silently then, as the pale faces herded us like buffalo. My people, with our black diamond eyes once creased with joy and our raven black hair flowing down our backs like the mighty rivers, cheekbones high with pride and skin all the the shades of the clay lining the streams. Streams. Streams of us. My people, the Cherokee, now we leave our homeland, this sacred place. Why? The pale faces. Your people must go to make room for our people, they say. But, Hialeah, grandmother, can we not live as one? Must we abandon our ways, our land, our herds, our waters, our dead? Our lost ones lie in peace beneath this very earth. My beautiful mother, Ioka, your daughter, our ancestors who toiled this very soil for generations. How can we possibly leave our dead? My mother's spirit still dwells here, not in the new land, here. Grandmother, why must we flee? Her black diamonds sparkled with fresh tears as she took my face into her withered hands. My dear Aita, you speak truth, yet you are wrong. Our dead are always with us. If you listen closely, you can hear their souls singing. Their song will guide our path. Our destiny awaits in the new land. Now the pale faces, they fear our spirit worship of the creator, the maker of all things. Our differences separate us from them. Young granddaughter, they wish not to know us, but rather to gape in ignorant fear than kill us. By now, her tears were streaming down her creased cheeks like the sapphire blue creeks of the valley. She would not survive the journey to the new land, she told me. I could not bear the thought of losing her, to never again be able to hear the sound of her voice, the voice that raised my mother, Ioka, then me after her death. I would be alone. So much walking. Pale faces held long sticks at us that made terrible sounds, loud and sudden, and left anyone in their path writhing in a bloody pain. They made us walk all day long without ceasing, oftentimes through snows that reached past my knees. But just before the snows came, the air turned a deathly, deathly cold, and Hialeah's health plummeted by the day. Fifth day of our arduous journey, she could no longer stand. Her hour had come. The dark cloud of loneliness loomed ever near and threatened to engulf me in its malicious grip. Now I tried. I really tried, but I could not get her warm, and she shivered uncontrollably, teeth chattering, breath faltering. A boulder of helplessness sat in the pit of my stomach. I was losing her, and I could do nothing. Aita, they want to do away with us because they do not understand. They are afraid, young one. They fear difference. We are not human to them. They do not treat us as brothers and sisters, children of the golden sun and the creator. For we are all bonded through our creator. Therefore, we mustn't harbor hate. We must forgive my daughter. I reared back in shock. Forgive? Yes. Yes. Aita, forgive. However, that is only achieved through the Creator's power. You cannot do it in your own strength. Time it will take, but it is our duty. I will always be with you as you follow your path to the new land, she whispered between violet cheeks. Just listen closely to my spirit song. And she was gone. Her body ceased its convulsing as her hand fell away.
Produced by the Holy Spirit.
made it to the end of life only to realize that you never truly lived. There was a study done, a hospital study, on 100 elderly people facing death close to the last breath. They were asked to reflect about their life's biggest regret. Nearly all of them said they regretted not the things they did, but the things they didn't do, the risks they never took, the dreams they didn't pursue. I ask you, would your last words be, "If only I had"? Hey, you, wake up. Why do you exist? Life is not meant to simply work, wait for the weekend, and pay rent. No. No, I don't know much, but I know this. Every person on this earth has a gift. And I apologize to the black community, but I can no longer pretend. Martin Luther King, that man never had a dream. That dream had him. See, people don't choose dreams. Dreams choose them. So the question I'm getting to is, do you have the courage to grab the dream that picked you, that befits you and grips you? Or would you let it get away and slip through? You know, I learned a fact about airplanes the other day. This was surprising to see. I was talking to a pilot and he told me that many of his passengers think a plane is dangerous to fly in, but he said, actually, it is a lot more dangerous for a plane to stay on the ground. I say, what? Like, how does that sound? Well, he said, because on the ground, the plane starts to rust, malfunction, and wear much faster than it would ever if it was in the air. As I walked away, I thought, yeah, makes total sense. Because planes were built to live in the skies, and every person was built to live out the dream they have inside. So it is perhaps the saddest loss to live a life on the ground without ever taking off. You see, most of us are afraid of the thief that comes in the night to steal all of our things, but there is a thief in your mind who is after your dreams. His name is Doubt. If you see him, call the cops and keep him away from the kids, because he is wanted for murder, for he has killed more dreams than failure ever did. He wears many disguises, and like a virus, will leave you blinded, divided, and turn you into a kinda. See, kinda is lethal. You know what kinda is. There's a lot of kinda people. You kinda want a career change. You kinda want to get straight A's. You kinda want to get in shape. Simple math, no numbers to crunch. If you kinda want something, then you will kinda get the results you want. What is your dream? What ignites that spark? You can't kinda want that. You gotta want it with every part of your whole heart. Will you struggle? Yeah, then you will struggle. No way around it. You will fall many times, but who's counting? Just remember, there's no such thing as a smooth mountain. If you wanna make it to the top, then there are sharp ridges that have to be stepped over. There will be times where you get stressed and things you get depressed over. But let me tell you something. Steven Spielberg was rejected from film school 3 times. 3 times, but he kept going. Television access fired Oprah, said she was unfit for TV, but she kept going. Critics told Beyonce she couldn't sing. She went through depression, but she kept going. Struggle and criticisms are the prerequisites of greatness. That is the law of this universe, and no one escapes it. Because pain is life, but you can choose what type. Either the pain on the road to success, or the pain of being haunted with regret. You want my advice? Don't think twice. We have been given a gift we call life, so don't blow it. You are not defined by your past. Instead, you are born anew in each moment. So own it now. Sometimes you gotta leap and grow your wings on the way down. You better get the shot up before the clock runs out, because there ain't no overtime in life, no do-over. And I know that sounds like I'm preaching on, speaking with force, but if you don't use your gift, then you sell not only yourself, but the whole world short. So what invention do you have there in your mind? What idea, what cure, what skill do you have inside to bring out to this universe? Uni meaning one, verse meaning song. You have a part to play this song. So grab a microphone and be brave. Sing your heart on life stage. You cannot go back and make a brand new beginning, but you can start now and make a brand new ending.
So this concludes the first part of our program, the first leg of the journey. Oh yes, there's more. There's quite a bit more. So we invite you now to take a brief 15-minute intermission, and we'll begin shortly for the next part of our program. Thank you.
Towards the sun, and never forget that the sky is the limit, planting kisses on our cheeks, hugs on our backs, drawing their love on us the best way they know how. Like my father. My father walked a daily nightmare so that I can live my dream. My father watered me with blood, sweat, and tears in hopes that I'd be ripe for the harvest. And I hope that one day I'll be as great of a father as she was for me, even not asking to spell it dead meat, sir. Like that, here it is. FATHERDADADYPOPPOPS. Like the slang, ask me to spell father. Where I am from, my life. Father is, always has been, and always will be spelled M-O-T-H-E-R. So open your encyclopedias. Show me your flashcards. Open your dictionaries. Because what Webster says means nothing around here. Around here, my father is sitting right there. And I love her. Happy Mother's Day.
I want to do a little something for those until we lost the age.
I'm gonna do that.
for us as travelers and sojourners on this journey called life, we have to keep our gaze, keep our eyes fixed on our destination. Keeping in mind that this earth is not our home. No, we're just a passing through. We do have a real home, a real destination being prepared for us. And as committed, redeemed travelers, some days it might get hard, and we may wander off the path. But in the meantime, as we keep our eyes fixed, learning that the daily tests and trials, they come to make us stronger, especially if we don't give up.
Confusion, manipulative things that get in her head, telling her things of what to become, what to be read as, anything other than a teen thinking of drinking and weed, and the thought of the worldly temptations and restrictions keeping her from the real thing, the real deal, that one thing that made everything worth it. She knew that she really wanted to believe that, but the devil was a sneaky being, swiftly trying to be in her everyday routines, distracting her from giving herself to God, giving time in her day for his divine, worthy, and humbly serving self. She was searching for the word pages, front and back, looking for the verse that can be reassuring to what she was worrying about at that time. So, as she sits at her desk late at night, with the table light shining on the thin pages, flipping through Psalms, her eyes barely open, but she was determined to be saved. She had heard everyone else's testimony of their life completely changing from their encounter with God, and this girl wanted the same so badly that she tried and tried and tried again, and each day that it didn't happen, well, she lost hope a wee bit at a time. Believe you me, she was trying to find joy in her journey so hard that she woke up each day ready to put on a fake smiling face that would prevent the others from asking questions and wanting answers, wondering if she was okay, if she was fine. She putting on loads of makeup to cover up the bags under her eyes. As a result of all of those sleepless nights, she spent pondering life. But that devil, that sneaky fellow, is but the annoying, cutting and messing with her strings as her real puppeteer is trying and is relentless to show that he is guiding which way she should go. But that little fiend constantly eating at her brain. So after a long day of holding in the tears, she knew it was okay to let some go. But one turned into a ton, and the next thing you know, a waterfall of emotion pouring and bursting forth. So she leaned over and grabbed her Bible and laid it ever so gently in front of her. And she knew that this was by the work of God. When the wind from the window blew the pages open to Lamentations 3, which stated so clearly, "But this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope." Hope, hope, hope. She read this time and time again, seeing what it meant, but still not believing. Every time she saw that word, she could not stop thinking about the fact that she had none. And oh, she wanted just some. And so, in that moment, she decided she could. And she would use that to find joy in her journey forever.
So as we walk through that journey on these paths, we can have peace and real assurance, knowing that we don't walk alone. One of God's greatest promises is to be with us. Yes, the great God, our Creator, He is with us.
Thank you.
English diction. If it could be translated into audio, it would sound like... From the saxophone of Lisa Simpson. Two words designed and strategically combined to form the biggest oxymoron in the history of mankind. Almost. But see, as far as the world's concerned, you could live your life vile and could almost get away with murder if you had a nice smile. You could almost meet folks just to almost sleep around and stop at your local clinic while you almost had a child. See, almost is no stranger to Satan. Here's proof. He only tells lies when they're almost the truth. And it's amazing. In our incompleteness, we find complacence. But if almost is one of Lucifer's many traits, then we are inadvertently good Satan impersonations. But on the contrary, Christ did his job fully, and he proved he was God when he died on the cross like it was his duty, and to pardon my iniquities that I committed rudely, he resurrected from the grave just to tell death to excuse me. But excuse me, this is your life, and that's one thing I can't impose on. But your body is God's home, which was alone about to get foreclosed on. See, an almost Christian looks right, but lives wrong. Can't stand the conviction in Romans, so they sit down to be comforted in songs. Never understood worship, but love to sing songs like, I surrender. Most. Cause it's far too expensive to spend your life on something that doesn't appeal to your five senses. See, nowadays, Christianity is like a Louis rag. No function or use, but we just rock it cause it's stylish. Not righteous, not but right-ish. So now God sees the pile of Ishmaels when he intended for Isaacs. And we're moved by how we feel, so we're saved when we feel like it. So technically, we've never really been saved. We merely tried it. So no wonder why we're never sold out when we return it after we buy it. Let me break it down. Because you need to be aware that your life could lack the very standards that need to be there, because on that final day of judgment, when God is receiving his heir, will he say, son, daughter, well done, or medium rare? Because even by earthly standards, it's highly insane for you to be spending all of your money days before you almost get paid like parents. You wouldn't send your kids to a school that's almost safe. And ladies, would you really date a man that claims he's almost straight? And that's not, and this is the very thing about God that we all try to get around. But his standards are like between two mountains, no middle ground. So a halfway life is unprofitable to you because after all those Sunday services, Bible studies, prayer meetings, and everything that goes between, God will say, I never knew you. And that's not even the worst part of living your life as neutral. It's that you were once Arctic, but it is your lukewarmness that is causing him to spew you, and this is the very thing that had me. I was bound and held down by the unforgiving gravity of my spiritual reality. I was a Christian, or at least I portrayed the fantasy with a filthy personal life, but God bless you, brother. How you doing, sister? Personality. I was a female, enveloped by guilt because I was stamped a sinner. I said, I was a female, enveloped by guilt because I was stamped a sinner. My message couldn't be received because I didn't represent the sender, yet I was almost delivered until that one day when I totally, absolutely, and completely surrendered. I took heed to a modern prophet who proclaimed it was time for change. Now I'm no longer bound to sin point blank off the chain. You can ask Umar Abdul Mutala, the 9/11 terrorist guy. He'll tell you the same. You don't almost go to jail when you almost blow up a plane. Like you don't almost go to hell when you almost get saved. Despise the cross that he was slain and thus the cause for which he came, but don't worry, I'm almost done. But before I leave the stage, we have all worked in sin, and death was minimum wage. I said, we have all worked in sin, and death was minimum wage. But if it wasn't for Christ, we would have almost got paid.
Let's go back. Let's
the beginning of the story. Let's say the dead man could talk. And he came into this room, limping. You know, because that's how bones walk. Let's say he limps into this room, looks everyone in the face, and says, hey.
Hey, hey.
I remember the time you gave me.
You gave me the chance.
You gave me something I didn't even ask for. Something I didn't seek, but now I have nothing to do but to thank you. Because I could have spent my entire life burning. But you came to me. You spoke to me. You gave to me. And now I just want to thank you for being. You have got to give of yourself, because it will cost you to share this gospel. If the dead could speak, they would all say different things, depending on how we interact with them. Speak to those in love, please. You don't need posters and signs and anger. You show them love. Speak to them the word. I don't want your doctrine or your indoctrination. Just speak to them. Word.
Let your gardener, let him use you.
And yes, it will hurt. And sometimes you'll cry in your room alone and wonder why nobody accepts you. You'll wonder why nobody respects you. Then you'll remember the dead man. And you'll smile. Because the next time he sees you, the only words that are going to come out of his mouth are thank you.
Stay. God creates. Hope is being in the worst circumstance, but knowing He'll get you through it just by calling on his name. Hope is knowing that no matter who's in charge of your country, Jesus' kingdom will always reign. So today I ask you, what's your hope in? A man, an object, or in the one who will remain the same?
The journey of life. Where do you place your hope? Where do you find joy? Yes, real joy. We're not talking about happiness. Yes, there's a difference between finding things that make you happy and knowing real joy. Yeah, this joy that I have, the world didn't give, and the world can't take it away. Because the source of my joy is not in circumstances, people, places, and things that fade away and change. No, my joy, my hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but only lean on Jesus' name. Some things you gotta sing to yourself when you're on the journey. Don't know what your song is, but we found a song. Yes, we found our song. It's a song that'll keep us as we travel along. It'll remind us for days to come where we find our joy.
Yeah.
dwelling with us this evening, Lord. And so as you take us away from here, Lord, I pray that you would reign in our hearts, Father, not only in the audience, but in the hearts of those on the stage here as well, Father. So again, we bless your name. We're so thankful that you got all the glory this evening. So in your name we pray.
Again, thank you for coming tonight. I want to ask you a couple of favors. Yes, as you leave, would you be so kind, first of all, to give a great round of applause to our band. I also want to acknowledge Mr. Ziegler, our upper school he and the upper school staff have been fantastic over the past, over the past weeks in being a support for us as a cast and crew to make this possible. So to all the upper school staff, to all the parents, you were so patient and trusting. Give it up for the Lord. As you go, we'll need to transform back the gymnasium. Okay? So if you have an extra hand and scrunch, will you please help us stack chairs? Seven as a pile. Okay? That'd be great help. With that, have a great night.